Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick. I'm back again. By the grace of God, maybe tonight I'll be able to do the video of praying for words for people. I haven't had time to do one lately. Brothers and sisters, by the grace of God, I'll do that as the Lord leads. But anyway, so I want to talk to you guys about this. Several things. It's a theme. Sometimes people watch my videos and, you know, it's... You know, in the natural mind, when we speak, as Paul said several times, as others, I speak to you as men, not as, you know, as children. I speak to you in the flesh, not in the spirit. My videos, I usually do is in the spirit, as the Spirit of God leads me. So, I have my audience that the Lord leads me to, you know, and I try to, speak to all different levels. But it's, you know, I got to be, it's, you know, I'm being led by the Lord. So I have to be led by the Lord. And then yet I try to reach out, you know, in my own thinking and try to, you know, connected at every level so people can understand. But a lot of times when people want to hear preaching, they want to hear, they don't, this is what I'm saying. Let me say it this way. People want to know, like I started these three or four different Filipino churches, okay? I got this laptop on my bed, so it's a little bit bouncy, but I decided to go ahead and do it because the bathtub is a lot louder over there. My son and wife are in the bathtub while I'm trying to pray and make videos. So I thank the Lord for their patience with me. I ask you to pray for my wife and my son that they'll be blessed for that's their contribution to the ministry. Brothers and sisters, and it's quieter over here. And then plus when I got it on the bed, even though it's a little bouncy, you don't have to see me. You can hear it. And number two, it also disciplines me not to move around so much. Brothers and sisters, I already got lost my train of thought about that. Brothers and sisters, when you want to hear, this is what people do. Like when I started these churches, you know, the Lord would give me all this deep spiritual stuff, like the videos that I make, all this spiritual stuff. For he who has an ear, let him hear. At this level, you know, and then the people would ask me, they don't want to hear those spiritual things. That is, you know, most people are like this because of their lack of relationship with the Lord, their lack of spirituality of the Lord, a lack of Holy Spirit in their life. They don't want to get, you know, it's just like the children of Israel. And that's what I'm trying to talk about, Moses and the children of Israel and these different analogies. When Moses went up, you know, then there are people kept challenging Moses. I'm not Moses, but anyone that is in the ministry, you know, that's a type and shadow of course, the Lord, but it's also a type of shadow of, you know, people being a pastor. Being a preacher, Moses was also a pastor to the people. So we as, and even the Lord was a pastor, and the apostles were pastors. So as a, you know, that's a type for all of us. Anyway, brothers and sisters, when Moses kept going up to the Lord and hearing from the Lord and all this, and there's always people challenging him saying, oh, you didn't hear from the Lord, blah, blah, blah. So the Lord said, okay, let everybody come up. You know, let the people come up to the foot of the mountain. That's when the trumpets blew and they heard the Ten Commandments and all this. It's in Exodus, and I don't know off the top of my head. I didn't look at it today. I think it's Exodus 19, somewhere along in there. Anyway, so they were so afraid of God, they said, we don't want to hear from God, you know, just let Moses, you know, they were looking for a mediator between God and man. Now God has given us one, that's the Lord Jesus Christ, okay? But at that time, you know, Moses was acting as a type of Christ, as a mediator, and the people wanted Moses to mediate to them, okay? So what I'm trying to tell you is the problem is the people are scared of this. And we don't want to have nothing to do with God because he's you know, he's so powerful and, you know, he might kill us if we touch the mountain and all that stuff. It says, you know, God showed his, you know, the lightning and thunder and a dark cloud and all this so much. Even Moses was trembling and shaking, you know, and Moses was afraid, of course, of the Lord, of the awesome righteousness and holiness of our Lord. Anybody would be, any human. And so anyway, the point is that a lot of people, most people are like that. And that's the difference with your denominations. You know, there's people who relish in the law and order of man's kingdom. They relish in it. Whenever someone, you know, and I've made videos and talking about, you know, the all these people on YouTube are not our pastors who are making videos and all this, and a lot of it's wacky. But on the other extreme, brothers and sisters, this is what's coming to my mind in the last few days. It's better to have a pile of mud with one pearl in it than a pile of crap that someone told you was pearls or gold, but it's all just a pile of crap and there's no pearls in there, there's no gold, pearls of gold, whatever you want to say. It's better to find one diamond. It's better to dig through let me try to give a one-liner for it. It's better to dig through a ton of dung to find one diamond than to be given a ton of dung and told that it's all diamonds. And that's what religion is. Now, you got to be bold. Now, it started, it came out of the Dark Ages. We're talking about Roman Catholicism, then the Protestant denominations, on and on and on. It's religion. It's man's kingdom, and it's not the Lord's kingdom. Now, brothers and sisters, that's what all the confusion about the rapture is about. There's the wise virgins and the foolish virgins. Now, that's talking about individuals, but it's really churches. Jesus spoke to the seven churches in Revelation chapter 2 and chapter 3, and only one of those churches, the church of Philadelphia, he said to them, because you have kept the word of my patience, or in modern English, because you have patiently kept my word, I will keep you out of the hour of tribulation or temptation that will come upon all mankind. That's the only one he said it to. All the other churches, he said, I like this about you and I don't like this about you. Repent of the things I don't like. Or he told one of the churches, I'll throw you into a bed of tribulation with Jezebel. So, brothers and sisters, there's Christendom, and then there's those who are followers of Jesus. Real, true, born-again Christians, followers of Christ. The wheat among the weeds. The wheat among the tares. So as I said, as the Lord has led me, it's been an illumination in my mind from the Lord the last few days to kind of change up what I've been saying. I had been saying, because people had been bombarding me with questions because of bad teaching on YouTube by people who are not preachers. And so in my own response of weariness of answering people's questions, of things that all Christians should already know lots of times, not always true, but mature Christians should already know lots of this stuff. But, so, and I'm not talking about people that's new and don't know. Let me throw that disclaimer in there. I'm talking about people that's been Christians for 20 years. They already know A, B, and C. They go on YouTube, see a video by somebody saying that C is not true, and they've known it for 20 years, and then suddenly they're all tore up because somebody said it. Have you ever heard the saying, believe none of what you hear and half of what you see? And I mean, that's, people just boom, just suddenly respond. They're worried about it. They don't have the faith that they should have as a 20-year Christian to sustain them through something that they know is not true. Okay, but, and let me also throw in this disclaimer. My job as a servant of God is to answer your questions as a pastor. I don't begrudge answering anybody's question, as long as it's in love, not someone that's, an atheist that's mocking and insulting. I can tolerate that to a certain point if I feel in my spirit that I can make some headway to win them to the Lord. Of course, I'm going to do that. But you got to choose your battles. And as I've mentioned many times, like the song, The Gambler, you got to know when to hold them, know when to fold them, know when to walk away, know when to run. The enemy will try to tie up all your time with one person, and there's no productivity. And that's the hardest part about being a pastor. It's to know when to discern, and all Christians too, for you guys who are, all Christians should be trying to evangelize and disciple people, okay? So, but usually it ends up pastors are doing all the work that the body's supposed to be doing. But I'll say this is for you also. You're trying to evangelize people, you're trying to disciple people. One of the great enemy's greatest tool is to tie you up with one person. It's just wasting your time. That's never going to get saved, never going to change. And then there are those who are the most big mouth, hard-headed, worst people to deal with. They'll be the ones that'll get saved. I mean, it's a matter of dealing with discernment, opening your heart and mind to be led by the Lord, what to say, when to shut up and when to speak, when to talk love, when to talk hell, when to talk healing, when to talk miracles, when to talk doctrine, when to talk baptism, whatever, sin, when to talk grace, all those things. You can have all the formulas you want, but if you're not led by the Spirit, you won't get there. So let me go back to what I was saying. So I've got off on these tangents because that's where the Lord uses me, because I know the questions that people have to connect it in, brothers and sisters. And I think that's why people who watch my videos appreciate it. I connect all these and follow all these trails and connect it. So, brothers and sisters, what I was trying to tell you is that it's just like Moses. Let's just use Moses as an example. When Moses went to the burning bush, brothers and sisters, the Lord gave him a commission and said, hey, I want you to go there and set my people free. I've heard the cries of my children in Egypt, and now is the fullness of times, as he had told Abraham in a dream. It's time for your people to come out of bondage. They've been made into a nation from a family into a great nation. It's time for them to come out and do my will and go into the promised land, all those things. And what did Moses do? He said, well, you got the wrong guy. I'm slow of speech. Moses, they say, he stuttered. I'm slow of speech. I can't do it. You know, and Moses kept trying to say, you got the wrong guy. And then it says God's anger was kindled against Moses. And then he said, okay, you got your brother. You'll be as God speaking to Aaron, and Aaron will be as your prophet speaking what you whisper in his ear. Okay, why did God do that? Because Moses wasn't looking at what God can do. Moses is looking at what he can do. Oh, they're not going to like me. They're going to stone me. They're going to get mad at me. Blah, 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 blah. Making all these excuses because Moses, and you know, all the people in the Bible, as it tells us in the Bible, they're all in the King James, it says an example for us, but it's an example in modern English. They're all as an example for us. I believe that's Hebrews chapter 11. They're an example for us of faith. So we can see at this moment, because Moses didn't know better. We know better because we can read the story, right? So we're no better than Moses. But we can read the story and say, look, Moses, the lesson for us to learn from that thing is, number one, if you see a burning bush, might be better to go on and mind your own business, or you're about to get into a whole world of serving the Lord. That's a whole nother message, right? If you turn in to look at the burning bush, the Lord's calling you to serve him. That's a whole nother message. But this message I'm giving is, stop looking at yourself. Stop looking at yourself. Stop thinking about yourself. Stop thinking about yourself. Jesus said, you know, don't just greet your own relatives and all that. That's what the pagans do. You know, if you help someone that can't help you, if you pray for the lost who are not your relatives, that's being like God. That's what Jesus tells us in the Sermon on the Mount. You know, you just keep helping your own relatives. Well, even the pagans do that, Jesus said. That's the NIV word for it. You know, even the heathens do that. They help their relatives. But to go pray for your enemies, that's to be like Christ, to pray for those who spitefully use you. Turn the other cheek and serve those the least among us. That's being like Jesus. That's what the Lord said. Be ye therefore perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. That's what being a Christian is about. Putting Jesus first, others second, your family and yourself last. And that is the problem, what I've been trying to say in my videos. Pray for somebody else's lost relatives. Pray for your enemies to get saved. And then the Lord's going to send somebody to save your relatives. That's why I'm saying a lot of people are thinking in a carnal way, in a selfish way, in a fleshly way, and not thinking in the Spirit. Be like Jesus. Read your Bible. Jesus talks about over and over and over again, when you have a feast, don't invite the wealthy because they can pay you back. They can have a feast and invite you. No, instead, invite the lame, the halt, the maimed. Invite people that can never pay you back, people with no money. That's the problem, and that's the lesson that I learned in a practical way. When I was here last year from August till December, I had several, you know, some rich people who invited me, and I went because, you know, in my mind, I was like, hey, maybe they'll build an orphanage. Maybe they'll, you know, that we can build some more orphanages for the ministry of the Lord, Joshua's ministry in the Philippines. That's what I was thinking in my mind. Okay? But in reality, God is the one. We never look to man to pay us back to all these kind of things, brothers and sisters. And that's the problem with people. The same thing is with your family. Even as Jesus said on the Sermon on the Mount, as I repeat again, you know, even the heathen greet their own relatives. Even heathens help their own family. Everybody does that. But to be a Christian, to be Christ-like, is to help those who you don't know, to help the stranger, like the Good Samaritan. You know, I've made videos on that before. The Good Samaritan, in modern-day equivalency, the Samaritans and Israelis were like black and white people were in the United States, especially up until the 1960s. But even today, seems that race relations in the ship in the United States is worse now than it's ever been. Of course, it's not lynchings and all that stuff that they had up through the 1950s and 40s and 50s and things like that. You know, the violence as much. But racism is still alive and well in America. And so, as an example, like the O.J. trial, they're having talking about the 20th anniversary of the O.J. trial. Then we look at the Zimmerman trial. It's like people are choosing sides based on race. Based on race. So we see that racism in America is still alive and well. So the Good Samaritan story is like a white guy falls and gets hurt and crashes into a tree on the side of the road, and then a white pastor passes by and doesn't help him, and then, you know, some other white people pass by and doesn't help him, and then a black guy comes along and helps him, picks him up, takes him to the doctor, pays his bills and all that. That's the modern equivalent of the parable of the Good Samaritan. And that's what We need to have the heart and a mind to help other people. That's why I say, if you want joy, you got to put Jesus first. And I wanted to get into all that, too, and talk about how we're seated in heavenly realms with Christ. And I need to make another video on that. But this one, because of so many immature people, so many carnal-minded people, I have to break it down and I can't get past the you part and the other part before I can even get to Jesus. I guess I need to go backwards from you to others to Jesus. So let's still talk about the you part. How we put ourselves first, and then those people that would benefit us, our relatives, on and out from there, to others who are strangers. And then not only rich people, or people that are our co-workers, our boss, or whatever, somewhere like that in the job, they could, you know, we could get a as they say in the Philippines and in Spanish countries, por favor. And that's the problem, like in the Philippines. Anything you do for somebody, they think it's por favor. They you know, when we started the feeding programs, the congressman or the mayor of the city, because they will kill you in the Philippines. There's one way to get killed in the Philippines, and that's get involved in politics. Try to run for office, they will kill you. We started our feeding programs, and the mayor sent someone to me and said, is somebody here running for political office, trying to run for mayor? That's what they want to know about our feeding programs. No, this is a Christian thing. We're feeding these people, and we're planting churches and orphanages and all that. As soon as they heard that, great, you're welcome. Let me know how I can help you. You know, and that's what it is. People are looking for por favor. They're looking for you scratch my back, I'll scratch yours. How can this benefit me? That's why Jesus said, when you have that banquet, don't invite your, you know, rich people. Don't invite people that can have a feast and invite you back. Reciprocation here. But invite the lame, the maimed, the halt, the poor. You know, someone that you know that there's no way they ever pay you back. And Jesus said, your heavenly Father, who sees, will be the one to reward you, the one to bless you. Now that's the secret to Joshua's ministry, brothers and sisters. That's the secret of walking with the Lord, is that you don't look to man to be your provider and your salvation and your deliverer and your help, but you look to the Lord Jesus Christ. That's the secret to walking with the Lord. He is our provider. Jehovah Jireh, God is my provider. I never look to people to provide, but I know that the Lord will provide. That's what you have to do, brothers and sisters. And then you have to go out of your way to humble yourself. That's the problem with people. They don't want to humble themselves. They want to debate. That's why it's almost, it's silly and hilarious and funny in a way, brothers and sisters. When people love to debate and debate doctrine, and they're living in their glass bubble, and they're really in their house of sand, in their house of cards. They're living in their vain imaginations, and it's all theory to them. It's just all right here because it's all about them. It's all theory to them. They've never led anybody to the Lord. They've never went out and, you know, done anything for the Lord. They haven't gone to a homeless shelter and fed people. They haven't, led someone else to salvation, prayed with anybody, things like that. They're living in a bubble, and they're hiding behind their computer. They're on the internet living in fantasy land. Now, the internet, brothers and sisters, like we're using as a medium, it's used as a bad medium and a good medium for pornography, for all kinds of stuff, maybe, you know, who knows, and then for preaching and education, anything you can find on the internet. But this is not the real world, brothers and sisters. This is like television. It's not dealing with people in the flesh in the real world, brothers and sisters. And that's why I try to visit people, so I can meet with them, lay hands on them, pray with them, and minister to them in person above what happens on the internet. But lots of people, they want to have endless debates, just like Paul talked about the Israelites having endless debates about genealogy and all that. They were talking about who was the Messiah, you know, the genealogy of, you know, who's got the best pedigree and all this stuff and all these kind of things. Brothers and sisters, the endless debate needs to end. That's what I'm trying to say. I'm trying to say, let's get out there. That's the message I've been given since I started my YouTube channel. Get out there and make hay while the sun's shining. Get out there in the world and serve the Lord, and stop debating people and on and on about all these doctrines when the people out there are going to hell. You know, when I go to the Philippines, how I got that message was when I went to the Philippines as a missionary, and I met with each place in the Philippines, which is pretty good. They have this like a ministerial fellowship, all the denominations, you know, all the born-again denominations, I'll put it that way. You know, your Baptists, Assemblies of God, whomever. They meet together, and I'll go there, they're playing basketball. And then when you try to talk serious with them, they start arguing about doctrines. You know, the Bible Baptist preachers will say, well, if you got, I'm not going to pray with those Pentecostals. They might start speaking in tongues. You know, it's usually the Baptists are the ones making the trouble. But that's not always true. You have your, we have the United Church of Christ in the Philippines there. And they only cater to the rich people who live in sin. As an example, as I was talking about rich people. As an example, it's called UCCP. Now, they have all the rich people. Any rich people that are Protestants will go to that church, like a Protestant thing. And those people are all the biggest sinners that you'll ever meet. And then the pastors are catering to them, entertaining them, tickling their ears. We'll never tell them about how to become born again. Never talk about sin, repentance, or any of that. It's just a ceremonial thing. The old, you know, the old mainline Protestant type thing. It's all ceremony and catering to those rich people to get their money and build the biggest church in town and all that stuff. So that's kind of the same thing we have here in the States. You know what I'm saying, brothers and sisters? Same thing. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I'm going to go. I want to make another video about this. I think the bath time's been going on long enough. It's been like an hour. So, but I want to make another video at a higher level and talking about how we walk in heavenly realms with Christ Jesus. As the Bible says in Ephesians, I believe it's chapter 2 or chapter 3, it says we're seated with Christ in heavenly realms. Brothers and sisters, we have all authority over the enemy. We are already seated in heaven with Christ. No weapon formed against us shall prosper. I want to talk about that. How we can go in the enemy's camp. You know, the enemy can fire all the fiery darts at us he wants. As long as you have your shield of faith, nothing by any means will hurt you, the Lord Jesus Christ said. God bless you guys. I'll come back with that video. Maybe I'll make it tonight. They can take another bath or tomorrow. God bless you guys.